Lord, thou hast been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever thou hast formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. Thou turnest man to destruction and sayest, Return, ye children of men. For 1,000 years in thy sight are but as yesterday when it is past, and as a watch in the night. Thou carriest them away as with a flood. They are as asleep. In the morning they are like grass which groweth up. In the morning it flourisheth and groweth up. In the evening it is cut down and withereth. For we are consumed by thine anger, and by thy wrath are we troubled. Thou hast set our iniquities before thee, our secret sins in the light of thy countenance. For all our days are passed away in thy wrath. We spend our years as a tale that is told. The days of our years are 70. And if by reason of strength they be 80, yet is their strength labor and sorrow, for it is soon cut off, and we fly away. Who knoweth the power of thine anger? Even according to thy fear, so is thy wrath. So teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom.
Pastor Joel A., Senior Pastor of the University Church, Pastor Odieka Walker, Co-Chair of today's program, Dr. Vivian Quarry, Vice President for Academic Administration and Interim Dean for the College of Business and Management and Chair of today's program, Pastor Everett Brown, President, Jamaica Union and Chairman of the University Board, and Mrs. Brown, other workers of the Jamaica Union Conference of Seventh-day Adventists, Dr. Merrick Walker, Executive Secretary of Jamaica Union Conference, Dr. Peter Kerr, President, Officers and Workers of the Atlantic Caribbean Union of Seventh-day Adventists and Vice Chairman of the University Board, and Mrs. Kerr, other members of the clergy, Mrs. Antoinette Eccles, widow of Dr. Audley Eccles, and members of the Eccles and Douglas families, representative of corporate and educational institutions, faculty, staff, students, representatives of the College of Business and Management, Mr. Basil Tabernor, principal, workers and students of the West Indies College Preparatory and Kindergarten Schools and Early Childhood Center, former university presidents, deans of the colleges and School of Northern Caribbean University, administration, faculty, staff, and students of Northern Caribbean University, ladies and gentlemen joining us in person, and those joining us by the various online platforms. Today, we are here to celebrate the life well lived of an educational stalwart, Dr. Audley Eccles. It is a sad day as the Northern Caribbean University family has lost one of its finest educators. His family members and friends have lost their loved ones. The workers in the College of Business have lost their leader, and the administration has lost a valuable colleague. Over the span of 19 years, Dr. Eccles served the university and specifically the College of Business and Management with determination, dedication, and distinction. And we are most thankful for the commitment to the cause of Christian higher education that he demonstrated. Mahatma Gandhi once said that, and I quote, "The best way to find yourself is to lose yourself in service," end quote. Another scholar, Ralph Waldo Emerson, stated that, and I quote, "The purpose of life is to be useful, to be honorable, to be compassionate, to have it make some difference that you have lived and lived well," end quote. These words well personify the man we are honoring today, and many a student would have been the recipient of his service, would have benefited from his expertise, and would have left NCU better than they entered these walls because they would have sat at the feet of this exceptional educator. Whether serving as an assistant professor, chairman, or dean of the College of Business and Management, Dr. Eccles always gave of his best. He was dedicated to the philosophy, mission, and vision of the Northern Caribbean University and sought to uphold its standards. His association with the business college brought credibility and depth to the curriculum, and as a result, students are looked upon favorably when they enter the working environment. His time spent at our noble institution is well recognized. He was humble, gentle, polite, sociable, and gracious in manners, and was extremely purposeful. Dr. Eccles worked at several other institutions before joining the Northern Caribbean University, including the University of the West Indies, where he served as bursar and the Bauxite Company. He enjoyed sharing those experiences with others. He represented NCU well in the public sphere by serving as deputy chairman of the National Quality Policy Council, emanating from the Ministry of Industry, Investment, and Commerce. He was also chair of the sub-working group number 3, responsible for goals 5 and 6 for the National Quality Policy. He also served on the Finance Subcommittee of the Canada Caribbean Institute. My high school classmate and adjunct lecturer in the College of Business and Management, Dr. Paulette Perry McLean, reminded me that while we were students at St. Jago High School in Spanish Town, Audley Eccles would travel from Dinthill, where he attended school, to visit St. Jago. He had cousins who attended St. Jago, but perhaps there were other interests. I visited Dr. Eccles while he was in the Mandeville Hospital, and when he saw me, he said, "Mr. President, they didn't tell me you were coming." And he proceeded to say how much my visit meant to him. He shared other things with me, including things he might have done differently. I stayed with him until someone announced that visiting hours were over, and that was the last time That was the last time I saw my friend alive. He treated me and my office with professionalism and respect, and I will never forget that about him. Before his death, however, most importantly, he reaffirmed his relationship with his God. So today, as we reflect upon the life and legacy of Dr. Audley Eccles, let us not mourn as those without hope, but let us look forward to the resurrection morning when, as a family of believers, we will meet Dr. Eccles for the grand reunion in the earth made new. Also, let us remember, family members, that earth has no sorrow that heaven cannot heal. And despite our hope of a heavenly reunion, I express sincerest condolences from myself and the university administration to those who loved and knew Dr. Eccles best: his dear wife, Antoinette Eccles, his children, other family members, friends, and other colleagues, and the team from the College of Business and Management. I am cognizant that it is sometimes difficult to see beyond your grief, but may his memory, his life, his work, and his worth help to comfort you in the days ahead. And in the quiet moments, be comforted by the fact that his laughter, prayers, and hope that he expressed will be a source of strength to you. And may that dispel the pain and bring smiles again to you. May God bless you all. Thank you.
Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, we have come together today to mourn the loss and celebrate the life of the Dean of the College of Business and Management, Dr. Audley Delroy Eccles. Dr. Eccles, a worker par excellence, has always been special at Northern Caribbean University. And in my capacity as the Vice President for Academic Administration here at this institution, I could always depend on Dr. Eccles. Even when he was not in the committee, as long as I served there, I could always depend on him to do my budgets. Dr. Eccles is an extremely special person in the College of Business and Management, and they are here celebrating with us. While they celebrate, while you celebrate, we anticipate that there will be some tears. But what God does is well done. Please be assured by the psalmist who says, "Sing unto the Lord, O ye saints of his, and give thanks at the remembrance of his holiness. For his anger endureth but a moment, in his favor is life. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning." The book of the Psalms, 30, verses 4 and 5. As we proceed today, I shall be inviting, after the singing of the hymn number 205, Gleams of the Golden Morning, the children of the deceased to do the first scripture reading, taken from Revelation chapter 21, verses 1 through 7, after which we shall have Dr. Robert Wright doing the prayer of thanksgiving. Let us stand together as we sing the Gleams of the Golden Morning. The golden morning is fast approaching. Jesus soon will come to take his faithful and happy children to their promised home. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. The scripture reading will be taken from Revelations 21, verses 1 to 7. And it reads,
"And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them. And God shall wipe away all the tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, Behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, Write, for those words are true and faithful. And he said unto me, It is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and end. I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son."
Here endeth our portion of the word, God's holy word. We honor it by saying, thanks be to God.
Let's bow our heads for prayer. Heavenly Father, during times like this, words get in the way. We're not able to fully articulate our emotions, and you understand. You were in all points tempted and tested as we are, Jesus. And you're a man of sorrow and acquainted with grief. And so you can empathize with us when we grieve. And Father, you know what it feels like to lose a loved one to death. Because like no other being in the universe, your pain was terribly excruciating when you saw your son hanging on the cross. And when he breathed his last, how heartbroken you were, not all of heaven with you. But then there was rejoicing on the first day of the week because your son returned to life. And so, even though we gather here today to mourn the loss of our loved one, we do so with the hope, the living hope, that there is going to be a waking up on that wonderful morning. The Apostle Paul says, if in this life only we have hope, then we are of all people most miserable. But we know that there is hope beyond this life. And that is why as Christians, we do not mourn as those who have no hope. We have a hope in Jesus Christ. And so we celebrate today your goodness in the life of your son. We celebrate his contribution to Christian education. And we thank you for all he did in your service. But we thank you also for his family. And we thank you for the assurance given in your word that you are a God of the widows and the orphans. You will take care of the fatherless and of the widow. And so we can thank you and praise your name for this assurance. Yes, they will miss their father and husband, but you will be a father to them and a husband to her. And we thank you. And so this afternoon, this morning, we're here to worship you. We're here to thank you. We're here to praise your name for the life of our friend and colleague. And most importantly, Holy Father, we thank you for that eternal hope that one day soon, as was read in the text earlier, Revelation 21, there will be no more sighing, no more dying, no more heartaches, no more pain, no more tears. All of these things will have passed away, and we will live in the presence of our Father, in the presence of our brother and our Savior, Jesus Christ, never again to be separated. We embrace this hope, and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
For our tributes. The tributes will be presented by Pastor Peter Kerr, the President of the Atlantic Caribbean Union of Seventh-day Adventists and Vice Chairman of the Board of Governors of Northern Caribbean University. Following him will be Miss Lilith Scarlett, the first elder of the Northern Caribbean University Church on behalf of the church. This will be followed by Dr. Vincent Peterkin, Associate Vice President for Academic Administration and Interim Dean of the College of Humanities, Behavioral and Social Sciences here at Northern Caribbean University. We shall then have Mr. Edward Morris, an Assistant Professor in the College of Business and Management, who will be presenting on behalf of that college, led by Dr. Audley Delroy Eccles. Following that, we shall have Mr. Basil Tabernor, the principal of the West Indies College Preparatory School, which school the youngest of Dr. Eccles' children attended, and some of your classmates will be here. And we will then have Mr. Anthony Hutchinson, a former co-worker at the Aluminum Company of Canada, Jamaica Limited, and a former assistant professor in the College of Business and Management here at Northern Caribbean University. After that, Mrs. Maxine Craigie-Rooms, an instructor in the College of Business and Management, will then do a musical item.
We are united today in sorrow and tribute as we stand in support of you, Sister Antoinette Eccles, and of your children and other family members, as well as the NCU family, as we join in this service of thanksgiving for the life of Dr. Audley Eccles, Dean of the College of Business Management, whose passing has created, I know, a huge vacuum in your hearts. I'm here representing the Board of Governors of the University on this very sad occasion. Sister Eccles, I know that nobody feels his passing as much as you and your children do, but I want you to know that the members of the board are all in this with you. We consider your loss as also our loss. We share your grief today. Please accept deepest sympathies and our heartfelt condolences. As I read the statement of his passing, which was issued by the university, I took careful notice of the fact that he was considered to be a man of great wisdom and unwavering loyalty. His sterling contributions to the life of the university made him a precious treasure on the campus and a key player in this institution. A very gifted and important academic on the team who will surely be long remembered. God used him to bless many persons by his loving, caring, and compassionate spirit. And during his lifetime, he brought inspiration and hope to many. I believe that there might be many young people today who are celebrating his life and remembering him as one who inspired them with the courage to go on and to achieve their goals. Today, we honor Dr. Eccles for his great wisdom, his incredible devotion to his God, to his family, his church, to his NCU students whom he lectured here on this hill, and to the country he loves so dear. I invite you to look to Jesus, who is our endless source of hope. He knows your pain. He himself was a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. The Bible tells us that he has borne our griefs and he has carried our sorrows. He has prepared for us a better world where there will be no more sickness and death, but constant joy and peace. When you get there, my friends, you will meet your beloved Audley again. May God help you to stand solidly on the promises of his word and know that it won't be long. Any day now, we'll be going home.
Good morning, everyone. On behalf of Pastor Joel Hay and his dear wife, pastor of the Seventh-day Adventist Church here at Northern Caribbean University, along with the Board of Elders and the Church Board, we present this tribute this morning. Dr. Eccles, a brilliant, forward-thinking, helpful problem solver, someone who found practical ways to solve problems. He was one who the faculty, staff, students, and colleagues in his department could rely on to solve the many issues that would arise. One of his passions was to ensure that the quality education the students aspired to was up to standard. He lobbied for the best equipment and software for the productive and effective running of the College of Business and Management. Dr. Eccles was proud of his students who have the potential to excel in the world of work, which led him to write highly recommendation letters for them as they sought job placements. Because he cared so much about the development of his students, he facilitated their trips to the Mercantile Lynch in New York, Chicago Mercantile Exchange and Future Markets, and the New York Stock Exchange and Mercantile Exchange, where they received exposure to the real first world trading activities. He provided seminars such as the W.D. Carter Lecture Series, Current Trends and Issues Conference, and he also included the Business and Secretarial Science Students Association in the College of Business Management, planning meetings and consultations. Before his passing, Pastor Joel Hay visited Dr. Eccles, who recommitted his life to the Lord. We know that this is a very difficult time for his family. especially for his children. Death is something that we will never get accustomed to on this side, because it was not in God's original plan for us. And so on behalf of the church, as we give this tribute this morning, we also offer words of comfort, and we ask that as you go through these challenging moments, as you look to the days and years and weeks ahead, that you will find comfort and that you will find peace in the promises of God's words, and that you will have the assurance that if we are all faithful, we will one of these days see our loved one again. So let us remain faithful, because we look forward to that day when Jesus will come and take us out of this painful world. May God be with you.
May I invite all the following persons to join me in standing. Dr. Vivian Quarry, Vice President for Academic Administration and Interim Dean of the College of Business and Management. Dr. Vincent Wright, Dean of the College of Natural and Applied Sciences, Allied Health and Nursing. Dr. Daniel Alida, Dean of the College of Education and Leadership. Dr. Simon Bwambali, Dean of the School of Religion and Theology. Dr. Paul Giles, Dean of Graduate Studies. I stand as Interim Dean of the College of Humanities, Behavioral, and Social Sciences, in solidarity with all the deans, and bring you tribute from the Dean's Council here at Northern Caribbean University, where Dr. Audley Eccles served as Dean of the College of Business and Management to the time of his passing. We're all very saddened by the passing of this very special treasure, a gem, a rare flower indeed, relished and nurtured by family, friends, and the wider university family. Plucked up, but not forgotten, resting in the hope of a glorious tomorrow. Dr. Eccles brought to the deanery and the dean's council a wealth of knowledge and experience from which we have benefited immensely. He was a man steeped in the development and interpretation of policies and embraced an excellent knowledge of labor laws. His business acumen contributed tremendously to and in our many discussions and dealings with students, faculty, staff, and other stakeholders, both within and external to our institution. What a legacy indeed. Now we have seen him come to the end of his journey. What a sobering moment this is. We thank God for having gifted him in such a marvelous way, and for the service he rendered. To God be the glory. And here we are today. God has placed a full stop, and we dare not put a question mark. Whatever God has done is well done. Amen and amen. The Eccles family, his dear wife, Antoinette, all the children, other family members, all members of the Dean's Council grieve with you in this moment of great loss, sorrow, and bereavement, and pray that you will allow God to help and guide throughout the process of healing. May His peace attend you, and His presence bring comfort and consolation. Keep faith and hope alive. God bless you all.
With me are some of the members of the College of Business and Management. In academia, there are two attributes that epitomize a true academician. They are educational qualification and industry experience. After spending just 5 minutes with Dr. Eckers, one could not help admitting that he was eminently qualified on both counts. For my fellow faculty and staff and students of the College of Business and Management, he was not only a dean, but a business guru, a practitioner, a coach, a mentor. And how often he would regale us with his experience, tales of his experiences from other industrial areas, whether he was working at the University of the West Indies, whether he's working at Alcon or in the United States, but they were all key learning moments. We always learned from him. How does the college family remember Dr. Eckers? Let's do some reflections. Dinelle Miller-Smith, the president of the Business and Secretarial Student Organization, says, "He was not just a teacher, but he was a coach and guide. He loved his students. His legacy will live long in their hearts." Conroy Thompson, MBA student and adjunct faculty, says, "Dr. Eckers was a mentor. He had a kind and nurturing spirit. He had a passion for excellence. He never settled for mediocrity. Selfless, stalwart, giant." Lena Melvin recalls, "Dr. Eckers was passionate about his work. He was approachable, receptive, and well-informed." Alicia Stewart reflects, "His legacy will live on through the lives of those he touched. It broke our hearts to lose you, but you didn't go alone, for part of us went with you. Gone, but not forgotten," she says. Andrew Carter reminisces, "In our many conversations, he always shared solid advice and guidance. He loved the university and the college, and he had great plans for the MBA program and for the college." Donovan Salmon recollects, "He was a true friend and mentor who spared the time to share his knowledge and expertise and to entertain discussions on any matter. I will surely miss him, especially his solid advice on taxation policies and corporate governance." Jonas Semigish opines, "He was empathetic towards others, always eager to embrace the challenges of workers and students." Victorine Petrikin simply says, "A giant soul with a tender heart." Maxine Craigie-Rooms says, "She appreciated his leadership and guidance, and she enjoyed the treats he brought, especially his zucchini juice, which was most refreshing." Yvonne Billings confides, "He was a conscientious and a hardworking individual who strove for perfection. He was loved, and he loved recreation and fun." And finally, Charlotte Broomfield, his admin assistant of many years and his right hand, "I'll share with you a part of an acrostic she compiled just on his first name, Audley. A, analytical. He was very detailed and meticulous. U, understanding. She says he took time to understand my points of view, even when I didn't agree with him. D, devoted. He was a devoted father and husband. L, loving. He had great love for his friends, his family. E, easygoing. Indeed, he was. Y, he was young at heart. Dr. Eccles enjoyed having fun, faculty retreats, and getting away. The College of Business and Management, the Northern Caribbean University, Jamaica, and the world have become better places because he came, he saw, and he conquered. Audley Delroy Eccles, taxation guru, technocrat, entrepreneur, teacher, mentor, coach, college dean, friend. Long live his legacy. Thank you and God bless you.
I move this tribute on behalf of the Board of Governors, chaired by Dr. Jacqueline Hosin Clark, the administration, staff, and students of West Indies College Prep School. Dr. Eccles' passing reminds us of the thoughts in Genesis chapter 2, verse 7 and verse 22. And the Lord God formed man out of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. And the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon Adam, and he took one rib, and the rib that he took from the man made a woman and brought her unto the man. Thus began the first family, a small group of individuals with one purpose, one aim, moving in the same direction. Dr. Audley Eccles found himself in the family at West Indies College Prep by virtue of being the father of four adorable sons. First, there was Ricardo, then Entico, Audley Javon, and Audley Devon. They were placed in our care to continue the molding and fashioning of their impressionable minds to help prepare them for time and eternity. As a member of our school family, Dr. Eccles would participate in our school programs as time would allow him. He was usually quiet, but would engage in a hearty discussion where one would discover his depth of thinking that would leave you in a contemplatory mode as you exit his presence. In the West Indies College Prep family, the children stood out. They were disciplined, well-spoken, and display Christ-like qualities. This speaks volumes to the kind of training they received at home under the watchful care of their parents. It was no doubt that the West Indies College Prep family, upon hearing of the illness of Dr. Eccles, joined the larger family at Northern Caribbean University in prayer for his return to good health. However, there are some plans that God has for us that are not readily seen. You see, God's plans and purposes are higher than ours. Therefore, we trust him fully. Dr. Eccles' passing has left a void in the home, in the church, NCU, and most definitely West Indies College Prep School family. The NCU nursery and kindergarten divisions and the West Indies College Prep School family, a population of 500 students and workers, have the family in our prayers, and stand ready to give whatever help we can. There is a break in the family structure here, but Jesus has promised us a place which he himself is preparing, where there will be no more breaks, because there will be no more sickness, suffering, or death. There will be only happiness and radiant health and a never-ending family enjoying the paradise of God. Until then, we wait, we trust, we hope, and fortify ourselves in his word. May Dr. Eccles rest in peace. Thank you.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Goodness of God. of the goodness of God. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Good morning, everybody. Evening times of loss, let us give thanks and praise to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I will be doing these reflections from two perspectives. One, the perspective of Albert Walker, who represents all his time at Alcan Jamaica Company. So the first one I'm doing is for Albert, and then I will do one for myself, from my perspective. Reflections on Audley Eccles from the Aljam family. Our dead are never dead to us until we have forgotten them. So said George Eliot. The Alcan Jamaica family, referred to as Aljam, would like to express sincere condolences to the family of Dr. Audley Eccles. As we mourn his passing, we reflect on the memories we treasure during our period together. Audley joined the accounting department in 1981 as part of the cadre of university graduates employed to boost the caliber of staff in the finance division. Others included Audrey Williams and Peter Hunter. Audley's job was to evaluate requests for appropriations to determine if they met the criteria for evaluation using techniques such as internal rate of returns. Albert Walker, who was the accounting manager at Aljam for several years, had the honor of working closely with Audley. He recounts that he could safely recommend approval after Audley's evaluation, which was always very comprehensive. Audley was very ambitious and was not merely satisfied to earn a reasonable salary from Aljam. In his quest to pursue further studies, he was granted UEAP scholarship, university, UEAP, standing for University Educational Assistance Plan, where he pursued and was successful in his master's in accounting at UWE in 1986. Not being complacent in his academic accomplishments, he went on to complete his doctorate in business administration from Nova University in 2003. He epitomized the motto of our old school, Dinthill Technical High School: facta non verba, deeds, not words. Howard Duncan describes him as a young, bright accountant who made his name quickly. He was not afraid to take risks. Everton Ritchie remembers him as one who craves for knowledge, placing high value on education. He was never afraid to put forward his own ideas. He was a vibrant member of the lunchroom discussion group. When he held onto an idea, he never gave up and often went away, researched the subject, and opened the discussion anew. He earned the respect of his peers and would often join his colleagues in after-work entertainment. After leaving Aljam, he worked as the dean of the College of Business and Management at Northern Caribbean University, where he stayed up to the time of his passing. Audley was a friend to all and an enemy to none. May the angels escort him to his final rest. So that was from Albert on behalf of Alcan Jamaica Company. The following is from me. What is the one most pressing challenge that Jamaica has today? Crime? ignorance, classism, racism, although those two last two, there's not much difference between them, immature students, unrelatable teachers, bad mind. Audley and I would agree that perhaps the most fundamental challenge that Jamaica has over the 60 years is leadership. Both of us benefited from a two-week course in leadership and supervision in Ottawa, Canada, sponsored by Alcan Jamaica Company. Though it was not at the same time, it's only during our time here at NCU that I discovered that he was also a recipient of this training. It is not that we do not have good leadership potential in Jamaica, but rather that our leaders often do not appear to understand what leadership is truly about. Leadership is more about coordination than about technical knowledge. And to coordinate, you have to understand the path to accomplish the mission. Albert's submission helps me to put some things into proper perspective. I don't think I met Audley until the early 1980s while he was in accounting, as Albert described, and I was internal auditor. I transferred to accounts payable, by the way, for those who are not accounting oriented, internal audit sits separately from the accounting, at least at Aljam it was, separately from the accounting department. So he was in accounting, I started in internal auditing. I transferred to accounts payable as supervisor in or about 83, 84, and I was granted a UAP scholarship to pursue my ACCA in London, England, about 4 years later. I have no memory of the conversations in the lunchroom which Everton spoke of, which evidently occurred while I was in auditing. As I recall, Audley and I interacted minimally when I returned to Jamaica in 1991, as he was the new manager responsible for fleshing out the new accounts payable system, which had earlier been implemented. Thereafter, we only had a passing acquaintance, but were no doubt enjoined in the Aljam spirit. I cannot imagine an organization that is more aptly described as one in pursuit of excellence than Alcan Jamaica Company. My real interaction with Audley began when years later I was driving on my way to Kingston and received a call from him asking if I would be interested to join full-time NCU's accounting lecturers. I indicated my interest and engaged the application process. This was sometime in 2007, going strictly according to memory. During my time at NCU, Audley and I had countless discussions and a few arguments. I remember once when we held widely different perspectives on a technical matter and ended up as if at daggers drawn. What stood out for me was that immediately after the argument, we were interacting as though there was no argument. This impressed me because it indicated that we were professionals who did not personalize differences, but dared to respect those differences as we respect each other's view. Audley was a talented, knowledgeable, and purpose-driven brethren who sought the development of improved strategies for greater productivity in business systems and was not afraid to put his perspective on the table, nor of being challenged on them. They say the good die young. Audley was a youth to me. And while I recognize that only God determines what is good, I dare say it was good to have met, worked with, and shared thoughts with Audley. I will miss him. This is not on the paper, but I just want to say, I had plans for Audley. There are things that I really wanted to do with Audley. It didn't work out. I wish to say that there was so much more that Audley offered that Jamaica has not benefited from. Because of our failure as a people to understand what life is really about. It's not about agreeing or disagreeing. It's about giving service with an upful liberty. After 60 years of independence, we still have not learned the wealth and essence of who we are as a people. In my opinion, a terrible failure of leadership. Check Isaiah 3:12. With this loss, I offer condolences to Audley's family. Let us bear them up in our prayers and ask our Father to care for Audley's wife and children in these difficult times. One love, till such time, Audley.
Should I feel discouraged? And why should the shadows come? Why should my heart be lonely and long for heaven and home, when Jesus is my portion, my constant friend is He. And I know He watches over me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know God is watching over me. I sing because I am happy. I sing because I'm free. God's eye is on the sparrow, and I know He's watching over me. Whenever I am tempted, whenever clouds arise, when song gives place to sighing, when the sparrow, and I know He watches over me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He's watching over me. I sing because I am happy. I sing because I'm free. God's eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches over me. Oh, I sing because I am happy. I sing because I'm free. And I know God is watching over me. God's eye is on the I know, yes, I know, God's eye is on the sparrow, and I know, yes, I know.
Members of the Eccles family and all of us here at Northern Caribbean University, friends, relatives all around the world, be assured that God's eyes are watching over all of us, especially in these challenging times. As we move to the family tributes, I would like to remind us all of the words found in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And I read from verse 3, which says, "Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, neither doth corruption inherit incorruption." I now invite Mr. Entico Eccles and Mr. Philip Eccles to do their family tributes.
Oh. Hello, everyone. So it's great to see this level of support. It goes to show the impact and connection my dad had, not only to many of you, but to this institution. So I'm Dr. Eccles' eldest son, Philip. I have with me here my brother, Ricardo, and my brother, Antico, as well. And I have to say, this is truly a sad day, and you know, one you always dread, as you never look forward to the passing of a loved one, especially a parent. But as you know, life on earth is temporary. Each day is never promised, so you have to make it count while you're here and pray God is on your side. So my dad, I would say he was generally a quiet person, more of a philosophical thinker, who was very studious. We would sometimes, I guess, refer to him as the big brain. He would often remind us that he came from humble beginnings, and as youngsters, he never missed an opportunity to tell us his origin story. To paraphrase, he would say, "When I was a young boy growing up, sometimes I didn't have shoes to wear to go to school, and I started out only $2 in my pocket." And it was his way of emphasizing that hard work pays off, but of course, as kids, not something you truly took to heart, but nonetheless, you understood. However, we felt the weight of these words because by dad's nature, he was frugal many times to a fault. And as kids, we always knew when dad did the shopping versus when mom did the shopping. And we took the opportunity every time to nudge him in a nice way, don't do the shopping. But above all else, dad valued education, working hard and took pride in his accomplishments. He would always push us to pursue higher education and a viable career. I would like to think my aptitude for math and science came from him. He was not a very emotional person, but sometimes hard to read, but he did strive to provide a good life for us. And we bonded over a number of things, such as sports, namely watching, playing football, cricket. As a youngster, you know, I remember many times out in the garden, he would roam around with us, and you know, have a good connection with us that way. And then later in life, you know, having a lot of in-depth conversations about current life, events, technology, things like that. And you know, it's sad to see him go, but my hope and prayer is that his soul is at peace. So sleep easy, Dad, till we meet again.
Hello. I am Antico Eccles. I'm the son of Dr. Eccles. My name is Antico Anthony Eccles. I'm his son. And I just wanted to take some time out of the service to reflect upon his life. And he, as a man, was very strong, and we all know that. He impressed upon so many people in our family, and I'm grateful for him that he was my father. I couldn't have picked anyone better. Sorry. Foundations are not made up of mud and sticks or sand and clay, but mighty stones. My father set a foundation I feel will never part. His legacy isn't a trickle in the summer rain, but a shower that puts out fires. He was one of the first men in my family to go to college. He worked jobs constantly just to make ends meet, and while doing that, he had to get a degree. Once he gained his profession, he had to fight for his rights. All while he had to study again and again just to memorize all the things that he's learned over the years. He used his wits and his head to get ahead. I'm sorry for the corny joke. When I was born, things were difficult and different, but he always knew how to make things work. He always knew how to get out of a difficult situation. And I know that he loved me very much. My brothers, when they were born, caused their family to double. Honestly, though,
It was more like they were double trouble. Many great people in my family were inspired because of him. I know my world and this world will never be the same without him. He was kind, caring, selfless, bold and brave. He beat the odds. He survived. But being in a coma for 6 months can take its toll. And he sadly passed. The last words he said to me was this: "I'll keep fighting for you. I'll keep fighting this." In a way, he was right. He fought to the very end. That's what a man does. It's what a strong man does. That is how you tell apart heroes and cowards. Thank you.
The sister of Dr. Audley Eccles, Mrs. Vida Britton, along with other members of the family, to come forward for the final family tribute, after which we shall invite to the podium Dr. Trescott Wilson, Vice President for Finance and Facilities here at Northern Caribbean University and a former Dean of the College of Business and Management here at this institution. And he will tell you more, much more, about the Audley Eccles College of Business and Management Scholarship. Mrs. Vida Britton and family, please.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for the opportunity of saying thanks to the university and to the faculty and to members of our family and friends. I just want to say just two words. My Audley Delroy Eccles was my baby brother. And I know the Bible. I live by the Word of God. But when he passed away, I was so hurt. I had to sit down and go back to God and ask him, please direct my path. Please show me why you're so angry. And I sat at my table. This is my brother, my sister, my nephews at my side. And I sat at my table. And in few minutes, the word, God spoke to me. The Holy Spirit came to me and he said, Vida, be calm. Accept, you know I'm God. I took care of you and I will continue to take care of you. So thanks for that moment. Now, when I sat there, I didn't go to a book, I didn't look at anything, and I wrote this little poem of my own. Can you read it for me, Chris, because I forget my glasses.
Okay.
So right. These are my words when I sat there.
Okay. The title is God's Garden, and it states that God looked around his garden and found an empty place. He then looked down upon the earth and saw your tired face. He put his arms around you and lifted you to rest. God's garden must be beautiful. He always takes the best. He knew that you were suffering. He knew you were in pain.
Mm.
He knew that you would never get well on earth again.
I know.
He saw the road was getting rough and the hills were hard to climb. So he closed your weary eyelids and whispered, "Peace be thine." It broke our hearts to lose you, but you didn't go alone.
Yes.
For part of us went with you the day God called you home. Tribute by Mrs. Vida Britton.
Thank you, and we will see you in eternity. Thank you.
Amen.
Thanks.
To Mrs. Antoinette Eccles, on behalf of my wife, Lynette, and I, please accept our deepest sympathies and condolences on the passing of your husband, Dr. Audley Eccles. We ask God to comfort you and your family during this time of pain and sorrow. My primary task today is to lift an offering in aid of and in the honor and the legacy of Dr. Audley Eccles. Be it understood, we shared a common bond, having graduated from the Nova School of Business at different times. The family of the late Dr. Audley Delroy Eccles, in recognizing his strong bond with the Northern Caribbean University, is offering a scholarship, the Dr. Audley Eccles College of Business and Management Scholarship, in memory of that great man. This scholarship will be awarded to a current enrolled first, second, or third year business and management student who is pursuing a baccalaureate degree in accounting or finance, the area of study that he specializes in. The criteria is outlined in this document, and students wishing to apply for this scholarship should do so at the Office of Scholarship and Student Aid before the end of July 2022. May his legacy in the field of education, primarily in accounting and finance, lives on through the award of this scholarship. I invite the ushers to take your places as you collect this offering this morning. During the collection of this offering, there will be an interlude of music. We crave for you, or for this occasion, your participation and your indulgence. Thank you.
We thank Mr. Oren Thomas, an alumnus of Northern Caribbean University, for playing for us this interlude of music. He also has been serving since this morning as the pianist for this event. We will now move to the second scripture reading by the children of the deceased, found in Psalm 46. This will be followed by the eulogy by a nephew of the deceased, Mr. Alton Genus.
And the scripture reads, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, will not we fear, though earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea. Though the waters thereof roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with the swelling thereof. There is a river, the streams whereof shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacles of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God shall help her, and that right be early.
The heathen raged, the kingdoms were moved. He uttered his voice, the earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Come, behold the works of the Lord, what desolations he hath made in the earth. He maketh wars to crease unto the end of the earth. He breaketh the bow, and he cutteth the spear. He burneth the chariot in the line of fire.
Be still, and know that I am God, and I will be exalted among the heathen, and I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge.
Good morning, everyone. It was on March 26, 1956, It was on March 26, 1956 that Audley Delroy Eccles made his entrance into the world, born to loving parents, Sarah Ann and Harold George Eccles, on the beautiful island of Jamaica, West Indies, in Gingerall, St. Catherine. His birth signaled the beginning of the indelible mark he would make on the world stage. Anyone who knew Dr. Eccles knew for a fact he researched everything. He understood at a very early age that the fear of God was the beginning of wisdom. And the child grew in stature and grace. He possessed wisdom beyond his tender years. Audley Delroy Eccles was the last child of 12 siblings, survived by his sister, Marilyn Joyce Eccles. Aunt Joyce, could you stand again, please? is Brother Jocelyn Castle Eccles, and my mom is Sister Vida Van Britten. Audley Delroy was the father of five children from his first marriage: son Matthew, daughter Cassily, son Philip, Brian, and Ricardo. The second union produced four children: his daughter Brianna, son Antico, twin boys Audley Duvon and Audley Jovan Eccles. He is survived by his wife, Antoinette Eccles. At an early age, Uncle Audley, as he was affectionately called, had a zeal for teaching and education. His career goals took him to many different paths through life's journey. In 1976, he obtained a diploma in business administration, major in accounting from the University of Technology. In 1981, Bachelor's of Science in Accounting from the University of the West Indies, Mona. In December 1986, Master's of Science in Accounting, received an award from Deloitte and Touche for auditing. In April of 1998, Master's of Science in Taxation from the University of the West Indies. And in June 2003, from the Florida International University in Miami, Florida, received his Doctorate of Business Administration. He was the President and Chief Executive Officer of Albright, provide various financial accounting, taxation, and management service, retailing software, program development by Computex, acting as an adjunct facility at Northern Caribbean University, CEO and consultant of Compumax, developed various financial accounting and management software and provide consulting activities and teaching services. He's the Dean of Business and Management at NCU, auditor of Ajay and Company, CPA, Chief Executive Officer of a family-owned business, provide advice to client in the areas of general business management, accounting, software, implementation, financial and economical feasibility studies, surveys and projects evaluation, strategies and product development activities, assistant administration to the Jackson Memorial Hospital, campus marketing advisor for DAYU North America, act as campus liaison officer for the marketing of motor cars to college student, financial consultant, pro-am consultant, deputy bursar, the University of the West Indies, lecturer, University of the West Indies, financial controller for Kimiso Limited, general accounting manager for Alcan Jamaica, acting credit control competent limited, a teacher at St. Andrew's Technical, senior accounting clerk, West Indies, home contractor. Unfortunately, I will not be able to cover the true extent of his knowledge and experience. I have only given you a brief synopsis. He was truly a remarkable human being. He is love for his student, teaching. Uncle Audley taught taught a student up to the very end. I think it was a day or two before he passed. That's how much he loves to teach. He will be truly missed, especially by his wife and children, all those who cared for and who care for him. He was indeed a faithful servant until the end. Sleep on and take your rest, husband, dad, brother, uncle, doc, neighbor, friend. We love you, but Jesus loves you best. The only way I understand it is Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto your own understanding, but in all thy ways acknowledge him. Thank you.
I now invite Mrs. Pearlal Ebanks Eccles, sister-in-law of Dr. Audley Delroy Eccles, to the podium as she does a tribute on behalf of her family.
I'm not even sure if it is afternoon or morning up to now. Anyway, I am here to help to celebrate the life of Dr. Audley Eccles. We want to, not too much to be so be mournful. We want to be happy also for him. What I would like to say is that I'm really proud of his accomplishment. I think I said that to him a few weeks ago when he was in the United States and I heard that he had only weeks to live. I told my daughter, first of all, can you hear me? Okay. I told my daughter that I want to go to see him. And she said, Mom, I don't think they want visitors. I said, okay, it doesn't matter. When I go to the door and they said I can't come in, I will be satisfied. So she took me and I went inside. Dr. Audley was in the bed and he had a tablet beside him. At that moment, he was so dedicated that he was trying to help a student virtually. And I said, what kind of dedication this man has? He's sick, but yet he's doing some work. And we talked, we had a good talk. And then I prayed with him. Okay, just what I want to say is that I met him about 58 years ago. And the first time I remember that I can recollect that he was in a tree, a little boy about 8 years old. He was in this tree and I was told that he was the last kid. He was the baby brother. And then he came down, I met him, and from then on and on, I realized that he had the potential of becoming something very worthwhile. And I thank God for him. And let me just tell you this quickly. Education is my pet peeve. And I was so proud when I heard that he got his doctorate. And he decided to come back to my alma mater to help the students. And as I heard, he was here for about 19 years. And he gave his all. He gave up maybe I wouldn't say a better life, but financially, maybe he gave up a much better opportunity in the United States. He gave up that to come to Jamaica to help his own people. And I really feel very, very proud of him. And I want to say to his two sisters that are alive and his brother, my whatever you call it, we should remember him always as a great contributor to the family and to our Jamaica students and friends and relatives. I just believe that for what I said to him and what he said to me, I believe that when Jesus comes, he will be risen again and we will meet in the earth made new. I thank God for meeting his family and meeting him, and I do hope that we all here will live, get closer to the Lord, because there's nothing else. There is nothing else. Nothing on this earth is worthwhile than the eternal life. So let us get close to the Lord and live the life so that we will have the hope of eternal life. May God bless you.
The time has now come for us to listen to God's words. And we anticipate that in the midst of our sadness, we will contemplate that which is about to be presented, because Dr. Audley Eccles sleeps, but we are alive and we remain. We do not know our fate. But if we heed to God's word as it is presented, then when Jesus comes, soon and very soon, we pray that we all will so live that we will be able to go home to live and reign with him eternally. The president of the Jamaica Union Conference of Seventh-day Adventists and chairman of the Board of Governors of Northern Caribbean University, Pastor Everett E. Brown, apologizes for his absence, and he has asked Pastor Dr. Merrick Dale Walker to speak on his behalf. Dr. Walker currently serves as the Executive Secretary of the Jamaica Union Conference of Seventh-day Adventists and serves also on the Board of Governors of Northern Caribbean University. After we would have listened to an item of music presented by the Northern Caribbean University Chorale, with them singing "It Is Well With My Soul," we shall be hearing from Dr. Merrick Dale Walker. This will be followed by the prayer for the bereaved family, to be done by Dr. Simon Wambali, the Dean of the School of Religion and Theology here at Northern Caribbean University, after which we shall have acknowledgments by Mrs. Antoinette Eccles, to be followed by the benediction and instructions by Pastor Odika Walker, an assistant professor here in the School of Religion and Theology at Northern Caribbean University. And now to our item of music. be away, the preacher. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So, when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? This is the word of the Lord. May we be blessed and may we reflect appropriately.
Thank you, Chair. It is indeed a challenging occasion as we have come together from far and near, all walks of life, to say farewell to indeed a noble man. I would begin where it is most intense, and that is to express to you, Sister Eccles and family members, on behalf of my wife and the rest of the family, deepest commiseration. It is not an easy road one person sings. And indeed, I would emphasize the same from the Jamaica Union, and not only our noble president, who is, as said, not able to be here out of circumstances, but I do so on behalf of all the five conferences in Jamaica Union. And the truth is, we are hurting. The NCU, our flagship institution, is not what it has been because of its programs and edifices, but because of those who, like Dr. Eccles, they stand in the gap and provide critical leadership and inspiration to our young people. And hence we lower the flag of our hearts. Indeed, It is not an easy road. And today we are gathered here to give our final farewell on this side of eternity and to give to a scholar, a thinker, one that was so committed, a royal salute of honor, and to use this occasion to, through the word of the Lord, convey to you that there is hope, not a figment of our imagination, but solid hope. Hope that is built on the rock. And we do not vacillate on this, because on Christ, the solid rock, we stand. And all other is sinking sand. But the belief in the Bible of the Lord, it stands. Let us bow our heads of prayer. Father in heaven, thank you so much for the honor that you have placed upon your servant and the person in the spotlight is so because you have permitted by your sovereign will him to sleep in Christ. Oh Lord, I ask that you will speak through me your words, and may hope indeed be seen and embraced. This is my prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. I present to you today interestingly so a curriculum from Heaven's School of Business and a text from the School of Theology, the Bible, the text from the SRT, and the curriculum is from the School of Business. I ask you to reflect with me for a moment on the mettle of this man. This man was no ordinary man. And you could say that if we had begun 6 o'clock this morning and we didn't have any song or we didn't have any sermonette, we could be speaking the truth about this man for the rest of the day. And to know that he had given quality service to Northern Caribbean University makes us proud. And we are satisfied that the Lord has given and the Lord has taken away. And we can say without any doubt that the Lord led him, and we can say, blessed be the name of the Lord for Dr. Audley Eccles. the curriculum from heaven, School of Business, is that which has an investment that is second to none. An investment that is second to none. And we have learned how to invest wisely and how to let our investment grow and produce. And we can stand here today and we, while we are wrapped with grief, we can truly say that we have made an investment that is second to none. And that investment is Jesus. Oh, how sweet the name. Well, let us look at the what I call and hope to defend the curriculum of heaven's School of Business. Firstly, I take you to Titus 2 and verse 13. And Titus 2 and verse 13 is a wonderful passage to set the foundation for all that we have been discussing. Titus 2 and verse 13 anchors that indeed we are looking. We are looking. We are expecting returns, and we are expecting the outcome of an eternal dividend. It says there, looking for the blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior Jesus Christ. He is coming because he has come already. He is coming because he has invested himself for the human race. And it says we are now looking. We are expecting. We are anticipating that our investment made by Jesus is going to pay off, and it is not going to be a figment of our imagination, but it is something literal. And hence we are looking. In classes, Dr. Eccles demonstrated literally, so the students would develop curiosity and they would see happening before their very eyes something that is tangible. And hence it says we are looking. And I say to you today, let us look for the blessed hope, because it is at that critical point in Earth's history that we will see indeed that our belief has not been in vain, because Jesus, who is the everlasting God, one who possesses life in himself, he has taken up that life, having paid the price for sin and death. And he says, I am coming again. And hence, our responsibility is to look for a literal coming of Jesus. Oh, how sweet the word. And you know, we are living in a time of unprecedented challenges on every side. And we are still baffled by the war in Ukraine and the brutality of Russian forces. And we know that that's not God's intent for the world, and that won't continue forever, because we're looking for Jesus to come and to break through the exosphere. Jesus is coming, and he will break through the thermosphere, through the mesosphere, and through the stratosphere and troposphere, and he will be here, and that will be it. We can say that we have seen the investment being paid off, because this world will not be the same, and he will establish his universe and his university forever, and our honorable will be those who have served in the earthly university with distinction. And then we have to now consider that it will be personal. It will be personal. And Acts 1 and verse 11 says, as there were curious disciples, they have just lost their Lord, and their hope was just dashed. Yes, they were left, as it were, in curiosity as they saw Jesus being ascended. Jesus, the Lord, their Savior, who came after the resurrection, and they had a bout of discouragement, and he was there, and they saw him as he bade them farewell, that he ascending into heaven. And they were again facing a vacuum, no doubt, like we are facing today. We can't imagine that school year will finish without Dr. Eccles, and a new school year will begin. We can't imagine. But Jesus ascended. And when he ascended, he left among the disciples angels to comfort them and to bear them up and to lead them in the path of hope. And they immediately did their duties, and they said, listen, this same Jesus, the one who you see going up into heaven, he will come again. Personal Jesus, personally attending unto our needs. This same Jesus, the same one who walked in Galilee. This same Jesus, the one who healed the lepers and cast out demons and raised the dead. This same Jesus, the same Jesus who went up on the cross, making the eternal investment that when a loved one is taken away, we can say we believe in the cross. That same Jesus on the cross, same Jesus who was placed in the tomb, the same Jesus who rose victoriously from the tomb, the angel said, this same Jesus is coming back. So I have no doubt that this same Jesus, he abides with you. He understands your sorrows. And already he has provided the network of support, relatives and friends and students and strangers, lives touched by Dr. Eccles, to stand by you in prayer and encouragement, and for you to know that the family is broader than your biological family, broader than NCU, broader than the Advent Church family that you have. But you have a family of God in the universe, because
We are in this thing together. We suffer together, and we will be victorious together. This same Jesus is the head, and we can rely on him. But you know, I like the other part of the chorus plan. Not only literal, not only personal, but public. Matthew 24, verse 27, and 24 and verse 30. Very powerful. Says here, verse 27, Matthew 24, "For as the lightning cometh out of the east and shineth even unto the west, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be." And verse 30 says, "And then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn, and they that see the Son of Man, they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and glory." Now, this is a powerful point, because it says, just as we see the lightning flashing from one point to another, just as how we see the trees being moved by winds, and just as how we hear the thunder, and just as how we see each other, just as how we can see this casket this morning, it says the coming of the Son of Man will be visible. It will be public. And he is coming with power and great glory. Now, we do not understand every decision the Lord makes, and we can't say why the Lord has allowed Dr. Eccles to sleep at this time. We can't say why. But you know, this one thing I know, that God is God. God is supreme. God is all-knowing. And we cannot thy purpose see, O God, but we can indeed embrace everything that is done by you. And we can truly say that what are we going to do when the Lord's trumpet sound? Because it will sound so loud that it will wake up the dead. It will be visible. And you know, I say to you that pirates cannot hijack it. Oh no, terrorists cannot capture it. Crime cannot cripple it. Parliament cannot legislate it. Putin cannot prevent it. Oh no, I tell you that no power on earth can stop it. Because God is God. He spoke the world into existence, and he controls the universe by just the breath of his mouth. And if and yes, we are a university that embraces the Bible. In the world today, you have so many strains of philosophies. We are fundamentalists, but we are not traditionalists. And the truth is, we believe the Bible, and the Bible says he is coming again. He is coming again. University, as we know it, will be no more. That's why, as we execute the curriculum God has given us, faith and learning being intertwined, we must do it with all our might and ability and conviction, because soon we'll have no more opportunities like this. But I say to you that as we see a great professor sleeping, we must remember that the Lord says, I am coming again. I am coming. But let us consider that it's not only literal, not only personal, not only visual, not only something that we can hear. But let's look at that in 1 Thessalonians 4, how audible it is. And verse 16, it says that he is coming with the trump of God. Do you remember that? The trump of God shall sound, and the dead in Christ shall be resurrected. The trump of God shall sound. That's what it says. And it will wake up the dead. I am looking forward for the day when the dead in Christ will not be dead in Christ anymore, but will be alive in Christ. And what a joy that will be when all the children and you, Sister Eccles, will see your loved one again. That is the hope. That is the joy. And whatever the university teaches in any of its schools, this is the essence. That when all of this is over, there is life beyond the grave. That is the curriculum for all of us to embrace. And then it is not only auditable. It's not only for you to hear, but it is also sudden. Sudden. And Revelation 22 and verse 12, my final text. Revelation 22 and verse 12. And I will go across the page for the other passage. It says, verse 12, and behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me to give every man according as his work shall be. And it says over here in verse 4, Revelation 21, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither there is any more pain, for the former things are passed away. So his coming is sudden, and it means sudden joy. It means sudden reunion. It means suddenly your tears will be dried up. Suddenly your joy, your sorrow will break forth into joy. And your night will break forth into morning. And your vacuum will be filled. And your expectations of reunion will be realized. Can you imagine the divine display of the kingdom being glorious? Matthew 16 and verse 27, that he's coming with triple glory. The glory of the Father, I look forward. I can only imagine the divine cast, the retinue of angels down the corridors of the skies, and the celestial choreography with the angels that would baffle our imagination, with lights that we have never seen before, and the arrangements that we have never beheld before, we have never seen before. Can you imagine the music we have never heard before? Can you imagine the sceneries we have never seen before? And we see the light of God with the angels from eternity, would say. Since they were created, coming down, Jesus calling his own. And by their own name and location, they shall arise. And can you feel the joy in the hearts of family members? Can you hear the shouts? Can you see the universe getting beside itself? And I don't matter who is looking and who is hearing, I am excited in Jesus. And I shall sing glory, hallelujah. I say to you today, weep not as those who have no hope. I remember we were coming from Battle Creek to Detroit trying to catch a flight early in the morning. Rented a car and we coming down on time, and there was a big accident. And we waited and waited over 1 hour and another half hour. And when we reached Detroit, all the flights were gone for that day. Our flight left, and all the flights except one. And we had a little hope, and we waited, and we said, well, we will see what can be done. And we waited. The last flight to Florida to take us to Jamaica for a very important assignment. And we watched the last person went. And we said, well, we were discouraged. And then when we thought that the flight was going to leave us, somebody came and the lady said, we can take, the lady said, come, run. And we were running and we were holding on to our luggage. And she said, leave the luggage. I will take care of the luggage. Leave the luggage. Last flight. And we left the luggage, whatever. But it was more important to get to Jamaica, and we left the luggage and we ran. And when we went, the plane was so full, and I heard that, I don't know, I can't verify it or validate it, they said, if you are going to be deported, they're going to put you in the back of the plane. And they put us in the back of the plane. And I tell you, we got a ride and we said in the back of the plane, and we said, listen, if it is even on the wing of the plane, even in the wherever, once the flight is taking us home, we are rejoicing. And it was the sweetest flight I've ever had in a plane, because it was bound for home. I tell you, this flight that Jesus is coming again is bound for home. Let us hold fast to our faith. We salute Dr. Eccles with the royal salute. And we say, be faithful, family members. Be faithful, community and friends. Because if we get even the last one to be caught up, we shall see our Lord and Savior and friend again. I challenge you and I encourage you, be strong. When the Lord establishes the university of the universe, be there. And I believe you will see all the faithful like Dr. Eccles. Amen. Be strong.
Greetings. At this time, we are offering a prayer for the family. Those of you who are not here on the platform with me, I just want to ask you to whisper prayers for the family. A time like this one, they need support of our prayers. They need the strength that comes from high. And I just want to ask you to pray with me. Give your own prayer for the family as I give a prayer for the same. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we have said it, that in spite of what is happening before us, in our presence, in our environment, it is well with our souls. It is well with our souls, Lord, because you are there with us. In a special way, Lord, we want to lift the family of Dr. Eccles to your throne of mercy. At this time, Lord, they need you. His wife, his children, old or young, his extended family, all need your comfort. Lord, we have said many things about Dr. Eccles, what he has done. But Lord, we know that there is a gap that has been created. And we want to pray that this gap be filled by your Spirit, who will be ministering to this family on behalf of Dr. Eccles. Soft-spoken servant of yours, I know the family will miss that soft voice of a father, of a husband, of a brother. Lord, come in and fill the gap. Our Lord in heaven, many times we rely on human beings like ourselves and like Dr. Eccles for our prosperity, for our future, for everything in life. But Lord, we don't want to forget that you tell us that you are a man of war whenever there are needs and whenever there are circumstances that threaten our life. We pray that, Lord, you as a general might come and surround the family of Dr. Eccles. Give them peace. Let them trust that you are in control. But Lord, also we know that you say in the words of David that you are a great shepherd. And because you are a shepherd, Lord, we know that when we put all these prerogatives together, you being a general and at the same time a loving shepherd, we know that every situation, whatever it might look like, will be under control. Take care of the children, the young ones, who may be asking themselves questions that we cannot hear. But you are there, Lord, to hear these questions. Why has this happened to us? Lord, we know you have the answers. And your Spirit will minister to them to give them the answers for the present and for the future. We leave them into your hands. Take control of the situation, Lord. Take control of the family. In Jesus Christ I pray. Amen.
Thank you, Mr. Morris, to members of the platform, faculty and staff of NCU, to all the persons joining in via YouTube and Zoom. I just want to express my gratitude to you for your support to us as a family. There's really not much I can say that has not been said here today of my husband. He was a strong, disciplined, loving, kind human being. I would just want to use this opportunity to speak to our children, to his daughters, Cassalee and Brianna. Let your dad's legacy live on by being gracious, strong, dedicated, outstanding women. To his sons, Philip, Brian, Ricardo, and Tico, Audley Devon and Audley Javon. Let his legacy live on by being men of honor. Live as he taught you, to be brave, to be strong, to be committed to everything that you do. There's no greater way to honor him. Everything that Dr. Eccles did, he gave his all. He did not know how to do anything quarter way or halfway. There were so many nights I would sit with him, and he would work tirelessly, marking papers, reviewing schoolwork. And even when I would say to him, sweetheart, it's time for bed, he'd say to me, honey, two more left. You know. But that was his dedication to the task at hand. And I will forever remember him. And I will forever be grateful to have had the opportunity to be his wife. I will use this analogy to describe what I'm going through at this moment. If you love your gardening and you plant seedlings often, sometimes you'll sow your seeds and you carefully go through inputting a seed one at a time into each cell. But somehow, when they emerge out of the soil, you'll find two attached. Now, maybe for whatever reason, you'll remove these seedlings from the cell and you decide to plant them together in the soil. Now, over time, the roots would become intertwined. They grow together. If the drought comes, they suffer together. If the rain comes, they flourish together. That was me and Dr. Eccles. He taught me so much. I will try my best to continue the work that is at hand, to raise these boys to be young men, and the honor for you to be the best young woman there is. Thank you so much to the NCU family for all the support you have given. To my mom, Dr. Marilyn Anderson, thank you for being that tower of strength for me. Dr. Quarry, there are no words to be said. Thank you so much. And to all the students participating, I would hope that you would let his memory live on by carrying out your task always with great integrity in everything that you do. And once again, I just want to say thank you all so much. Have a pleasant evening.
At this time, I'd like to invite you to sing with me the closing hymn, When We All Get to Heaven.
Onward to the prize before us.
Now, O Lord, God of consolation and comfort, God of light and life, grant us hope, strength, and grace. May we all be prepared in heart and mind, in life and deed, to meet you at your coming in peace, and with pleasure to see your face. Amen. Invited to be seated as I give instructions. The internment will be on Tuesday, May 24 at 10 a.m. Pastor A indicates that all of you are invited to meet at the funeral home by 9:45 a.m., Della Penna's funeral home, 8 Park Crescent, and then you would proceed to the Oak Lawn Memorial Gardens, Dunsinane, Manchester. Let us continue to give our support to the family, even hereafter. So we don't go to the internment immediately when we leave this building. The internment will be on Tuesday, all right, at 10 a.m. So I ask that we proceed in this way. The platform participants will march to the front, followed by the casket. Then the relatives will follow behind. Then the administrators of NCU, the College of Business and Management, the workers of NCU, and the rest of the audience. We thank God for his blessings today as we celebrate the life of Dr. Eccles. We ask for your continued support to the family. God bless you all. Ask that the pallbearers stand in place, please.